Let me just introduce our guest here today, Gerald Knaus, who is the founding chairman of the European Stability Initiative. He studied in Oxford, in Brussels, and in Bologna, taught economics at the State University in the Ukraine, and worked for 5 years in Bulgaria and Bosnia for non-governmental organizations and international organizations. He also was the director of the Lessons Learned Unit of the EU Pillar of the UN mission in Kosovo, and he's the founding member of the European Council on Foreign Relations and an associate fellow at the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy at the Harvard University Kennedy School. So I'm very happy that we are here together today. Please get out.
Thank you, Peter. Well, welcome everybody. First of all, my thanks and gratitude to the European Institute and Professor Ataman and to Bilgi University for hosting us here. It's not the first event we do here in the 7 years that ESI has come to Turkey, but it's one of the most interesting because we're presenting some research that a whole team of ESI fellows has done. And now we are complete. Introducing some research that a whole team of ESI fellows has done. Let me first perhaps introduce ESI in like two words and then say something about this project and introduce my colleagues. ESI is a think tank based in Berlin, but it's very multinational. We have offices in Brussels, Vienna, the Balkans, and Istanbul. Istanbul is our biggest office. And we've been working a lot on issues of European enlargement and transformation in Southeast Europe and the future of Europe. Currently, we're doing a number of projects in Turkey. We are producing a new report coming up in a few weeks on civil-military relations. We're also producing a report on visa issues. We have put together a team of former interior ministers in Europe to push for visa liberalization for Turkey. We have done that for the Balkans the last 3 years, making the argument that it is in the European interest to give Turkey a visa roadmap leading to full liberalization, as it has been done in the case of the Balkans. But we have also been working very much on Turkey-EU relations. Now, one way to explain to skeptical Europeans how Turkey is developing was to do detailed field research in Turkey. I mean, in 2005, we produced a report which created, to our surprise, a lot of debate inside Turkey on the Islamic Calvinists in Central Anatolia, where we decided to explain Turkey by looking at the center of the country, a province, Kayseri, with 1 million people, and show the changes in the last 10 years by describing them there. Since then, we've worked on a lot of issues, including women's issues, the story of the civil and penal code reform, the story of the Turkish feminist movement, pushing the government to bring about civil code reform, and penal code reform, especially in 2004. And the last report we did, and I will refer to this now, is on Turkey-EU accession. This came out late last year, November. A very special relationship, why Turkey's EU accession process will continue, where we make the argument that Turkey and the EU are in fact already married, and you've mentioned Catholic law. They are married as Catholic couples are, which means there is no choice of divorce. Neither side has any interest in ever breaking off this marriage. Now, you can have bad phases. At times, you might even have a little affair, as Turkey had with the Middle East for the last 2 years. But in the end, you discover that, you know, you are married, and this marriage is actually based on profound interest as well as emotions. But in any Catholic marriage that cannot be divorced, you can have a bad phase. And at the moment, it seems very much as if particularly the EU accession process has entered such a phase. And what we wanted to do was to research to what extent perceptions and misperceptions have actually contributed to this phase of misunderstandings and sometimes tensions between Europe and Turkey. Now, I arrived in Turkey in 2004 with our team, and at that time there was great optimism. I remember meeting a friend working for a big Turkish NGO think tank who told me that you're coming too late, it's all over. You know, Turkey starts accession talks in December and then it's going to be a boring country. You know, just like all other European countries are boring and nothing ever happens there. And of course, this was wrong for Europe and it was definitely wrong for Turkey. Now in 2002, really the turning point. Of course, in Helsinki, Turkey got EU accession. perspective of candidate status, but in 2002 it was when the EU said, okay, fine, this candidate status means something. If you meet the Copenhagen political criteria, we will start accession talks with no delay. At that time, the European Union felt prime of its power. This was a moment, remember, when everybody wanted to join Europe. I mean, Europe was inspiring revolutions throughout the continent. Milosevic was overthrown by people waving the European flag. There was soon to be the color revolutions in Georgia, in Ukraine. People wave European flags saying, we want to join too. Everybody was pressing. This was before 10 countries joined in 2004. And of course, in Turkey too, there was this sense of enthusiasm. Turkey emerging from a decade of crisis and a total collapse of its economy once again in 2001, and then a political tsunami in the elections with 90% of MPs not re-elected. Now, it's changed very much. If we look today, Europe is confused and in crisis and uncertain, while Turkey is growing at 9% and looks relatively confident or overconfident even. So we wanted to see how the Europeans today look at Turkey. And we put together a team of five fellows, four of whom are here, who have since January been monitoring the coverage of the European press and produced detailed chronologies of selective stories that we felt really capture ways in which Turkey is described. All of them partly are already or will be on our website very, very soon. Some of them already are. There'll also be a summary. And there will also be descriptions, manuals as we call them, of everybody in those five countries who is discussing Turkey. So if you want to influence European decision makers and want to know who are the correspondents who write about Turkey in France, who are the politicians who take decisions on Turkey, who are the think tanks, the interest groups, the business associations that do anything related to the debate on Turkey, you can go on our website. We have a few of them already, but they'll all be updated, like here on Poland, a manual which lists with email addresses and descriptions all the people who shape debates on Turkey and enlargement. So this is an attempt to contribute to this, and our fellows have been doing this for now almost a year. They are all here now. We've met the last 2 days to discuss what we found. Marianne from the Netherlands, Dominic from actually Austrian, but he's been living and monitoring a Belgian debate, Olivier from Paris, and Natasha, who's been based with one of the leading German think tanks in Berlin, covering the debates in those countries. We chose five countries that we felt were difficult. You know, the Netherlands, Belgium, Germany, Austria and France are the countries that in the last few years have made the most difficulties in the EU accession process with a lot of doubts. And we wanted to see how the media cover and debate Turkey. So this is not research on political opinions. We didn't interview decision makers. We did that in other projects on the Netherlands and Austria. This is on the media. Now, what have we found? I won't go into a lot of detail because, first of all, you can look at the reports yourself. And secondly, all the fellows are here and they can also contribute in the debate and explain something about their countries. Just a few highlights. There are actually surprisingly large differences between those countries and their coverage of Turkey. I mean, a striking one between France and Germany, which of course is rooted in big differences in these countries' relationships to Turkey. I mean, in France, what struck us was the relative absence of debate. I mean, you would have expected the French to discuss Turkey a lot, but in fact, there was a lot of rather dispassionate coverage, not on the front pages ever, but somewhere deeper in the newspapers, describing what was happening as if it was happening on another continent. You know, there was not much relationship between French debates on France and what was happening in Turkey, or even debates on Europe and what was happening in Turkey. The highlight of this coverage, the one story that really stuck to all of our brains as we read through the chronology, was of course President Sarkozy's visit to Ankara, as you all know, the first visit since 1991, which in itself is telling, a visit that lasted only a few hours, as you probably know, and as it was widely noticed in Turkey, and a visit that became famous, and this was picked up in the French press by President Sarkozy chewing gum, which was rightly probably seen as a sign of not full respect for his hosts. And of course, there was the funny story that the mayor of Ankara then decided to also chew gum, telling the press that there is such a thing as reciprocity in diplomacy. So if the French president comes chewing gum, I, as the mayor of Ankara, will also chew gum. Which in a sense gives you a sense of the ridiculousness. I mean, these are two big European powers who really have shaped Europe and are important and matter and have had a long relationship, as we all know. You know, and this is the sort of coverage you've had. And emotional coverage. Most of the coverage was not very emotional. So it wasn't really that there was a lot of prejudice in the French press. The journalists have been covering Turkey have given, we find, and you can check this yourself, a relatively balanced picture of what is happening in Turkey. But it was extremely distant, as if it happens on another planet. Now, Germany is the opposite. Huge amount of coverage on Turkey, despite all the global events. You know, the Euro crisis and the Arab Spring and, of course, a war ongoing in Afghanistan. A lot of coverage on Turkey. Very much at the center of domestic debates, and Peter will talk about it a lot more. And, of course, a lot of activity in terms of diplomatic visits, and each of these visits, again, triggering huge debates. I mean, it. Prime Minister Erdogan has become a really famous figure in Germany, polarizing German public opinion almost as much as Turkish public opinion. I mean, there's very little he can say when it comes to Germany that doesn't create huge debates, and you have the feeling that at least 20 German politicians are already sitting in their positions, waiting to shoot off the arguments, knowing sort of what he will say, and then there's always somebody from the CSU in Bavaria saying, right before he opens his mouth, let's stop the accession talks because Turkey has proven once again to be unfit. But in fact, beyond this superficial sort of game of provocation and reaction, very intense coverage and very detailed. It is, to us, amazing how German coverage of Turkey has improved in the last few years. Not just the number of correspondents that has increased. If you go back to a book produced in 2004, Die Türkei und Europa, Die Positionen, The Positions, which is a summary of the debate on Turkey at that time in Germany, you will find that of all the people who discuss here, most of them fit one profile. They are elderly men with gray hair, quite a few of them historians. And it's the historians who give their views on whether Turkey fits into European civilization and has had a renaissance and those kinds of arguments. Now, there is literally, I think there's one woman in here, and there are basically no German Turks. I mean, I think, again, one that is participating. This has completely changed. Today, in the last few years, you've had a very intense debate, lots of German, Turkish voices, I mean, German citizens of Turkish origin participating in the debate, debate that for a number of years was dominated by German-Turkish women and their books, and that has really exploded. And if you look at the coverage of this just in the last year, you'll see how central it has become. Now, we try to understand how balanced this coverage is, so we looked at a few issues. And this is the paper we are producing now, and we would like your feedback because we can still work it in. But we looked, for example, at the coverage this summer of the resignation of the generals. And it was quite striking, just to take the example of Austria. Now, the Austrian press, which Austria, of course, as you know, famously skeptical towards Turkey. But the coverage of events in the summer in Austria, relatively similar to, let's say, France, generally rather positive. I mean, there was a lot of talk about a dramatic breakthrough for democracy in Turkey, big change, a new era, but at the same time, a lot of caution. I mean, if you look at the typical articles would say, you know, whether this successful and to be welcomed attempt to break the influence of the military really means a step towards more democracy remains to be seen. This is very much also the coverage in France. A lot of general assessments which say turning point, game over, end of a long struggle, extraordinary situation, just quoting from a few of the press, but also a lot of coverage that includes the words authoritarian temptation, civil society must act as a check on power, a challenge, this sense of danger and opportunity. So if you actually look at this coverage, and there was a lot, I would say, you know, if you're a Turkish observer, it is relatively hard to find much fault with it. Now, there are a few exceptions, like the Telegraph in the Netherlands, which basically says, well, Turkey will immediately, now that the military is no longer in power, will stop being a Western ally, because Turkey has only been in the West because of the army's influence, this sort of coverage. But that is actually relatively rare. The Telegraph, of course, is an influential paper in the Netherlands, conservative. Then there is a lot of coverage on Turkey's economic transformation, stories in France, on Turkey developing all these embassies in Africa, trading with the Middle East. Such stories in Austria, which of course has been the number one investor in Turkey last year. These stories are being picked up, but again balanced by coverage, particularly since January, of problems of civil rights and democratic freedoms. I mean, all the press picks up the issues of freedom of the press, arrests of journalists, problems in the judiciary, always with this sense of tentative judgment. We don't quite know where this will go. Let's watch this carefully. Let's see if there'll be a new constitution. So actually, if you look at the quality press, and again, you can find exceptions, and you can find very prejudiced positions, but if you look at the quality press, it's a relatively balanced picture. Now, let me add, I think the same is true for the debate in Germany in particular, when it comes to Turkish integration. There has been, of course, this explosion of discussion around the book by Mr. Sarrazin, which was a publishing triumph, very widely sold book, I think more than 1 million copies sold by now. But then again, as opposed to France, Germany does create, this is Der Stern, this is a cover page, but recently, turbo state or turbo country, Turkey, from an outsider to a growing power, the country is booming, is a model for the Arab world. This is rather unusual that a foreign country, is put on the cover of a big German weekly magazine. And what you find in Germany too is that when it comes to the domestic debate on integration, the political elite and most of the journalists have actually been resisting this extremely strong populist pull that came after the book by Mr. Sarrazin. And I'm sure Peter will talk about it. There was a time when German Turks were discussed through this image, Knallhart, which was a book about Neukölln, which describes this part of Berlin as basically, Somalia, dominated by Arab and Turkish gangs, going after, innocent Germans who, lose their job and have to move there and then get brutalized by these dangerous migrants. But actually, in the last year, there has been a debate, and it's not just that this book by Patrick Barnas on the panic mongers, it's not just that this book has been coming out, of course it hasn't sold nearly as much as Mr. Sarrazin, but the interesting thing is it has very much reflected a new sense among Germany's elites. This book actually says that the German fear of Islam is exaggerated, German fear of Turks is based on the prejudice. It's the sort of argument that the German Minister of Justice has been making, Lighthizer Schnallenberger, repeatedly in op-eds, saying that Germany is looking at its Muslim population and its Turks more like German Protestants looked at German Catholics in the 19th century, were full of prejudice and misunderstanding. And the interesting thing is when Patrick Barnas put out this book, almost all the highbrow publications, the serious newspapers, beginning with, this is Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeitung, he's the head of the Feuilleton there, his counterpart at Süddeutsche Zeitung wrote a long essay strongly defending this. Die Zeit wrote another, series of essays defending this. And it was quite striking that in the political elite, you don't have a Gerd Wilders in Germany. You haven't had anybody picking up the Sarrazin line. So what does this mean to conclude for the perception of Turkey? It means that in some sense, there is some reason for optimism. The extreme ignorance, which we still found a few years ago, is hard to sustain at this moment. There is a sense that Turkey matters more. Now, this is much stronger in Germany, Austria, the Netherlands, than it is in France or Belgium. But still, secondly, the debate is less ideological than it used to be in its coverage of Turkey, partly because there are more people covering Turkey. Again, this is particularly true for Germany. And thirdly, it is more nuanced. These old stories where it was very clear, there were two parties and people had to pick the side and they were either for the AKP as a democratizing force or they were for the military as a secularizing force. I think this kind of coverage has given way to a more sophisticated understanding of Turkey as a country with lots of opportunities and still quite a lot of challenges. Now, I leave it at that, but I invite you all to go to our website, visit, these are all issues on which we have reports. Visit our reports, but in particular also visit the chronologies on the debates by our fellows and also ask them questions if you want in the debate because they're all here.